Hi, welcome to everyone's favourite segment, Mailbag. Yes, let's get straight into it. Oh, I've got a couple of shelves full, won't get through it. Let's go. First one up comes from Michael DeFresne, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. Been waiting for this one. Thank you very much, Michael. That's why I opened it first. He's got a book in here. Spoiler alert, I don't know what sort of book it is. That's not what I'm after. I'm after the used electronics in here. So let's rip this one open. I won't be able to do anything with it today because it requires assembly. And no, it's not a kit. We have a letter. G'day, Dave. Oh, he didn't say, he said good day, not g'day. Anyway, on one of your previous videos, you mentioned that you enjoy the history of the atomic bomb. I do. I'm a big nuclear history and atomic bomb buff. I really am. A few years back, I happened upon the enclosed book of a fellow named John Costa Mullen, self-published book on his project to collect all the available public data and build a replica of the little boy plutonium bomb. That's not going to get him in trouble, is it? Apart from the book, The Making of the Atomic Bomb by Richard Rhodes, which is fantastic, Pulitzer Prize winning book, highly recommend it if you've never read it, about the history and development of the atomic bomb. It's basically a sort of like a biography of all the physicists who actually developed it. It's fantastic. Have a read, definitely. I'll link it in down below. This is one of the few books with this level of detail. Yes, Rhodes' book is much more scholarly. It is. That's why it won the Pulitzer Prize. And thank you very much, Mike. Self-published. Oh, look at that. Self-published book. Atom Bombs. Fantastic. This is going to get this video flagged by whoever three-letter department it is in the United States of America that takes care of this thing. The top secret inside story of Little Boy and Fat Man, John Costa Mullen. Self-published, but I'll try and link it in down below. Oh, fantastic photos. Look at this. Oh, this is a Bobby Dazzler. I'm going to love reading this. Unclassified. It's okay. Uncle Sam, it's all unclassified. It's all right. Happened back in the 40s. Oh, great photos. This is terrific stuff. Thank you very much, Michael. I haven't seen such detailed photos. Wow. Wow, that's terrific stuff. So awesome. That is, wow, that's one of the coolest mailbag items I've had in a long time. Oh, by the way, the little boy bomb, it was actually a uranium gun type device. The plutonium device was the Fat Man, which had the plutonium implosion device with the plutonium core and all the separate charges around the outside. Even today, actually, you can buy... You can buy certain types of MOSFETs and other devices which they deem to be suitably fast enough for use in implosion type plutonium bombs. So they're like heavily export restricted and things like that. So yeah, there are a couple of parts out there. If people actually know the specific ones, I saw them once many years ago. I don't remember them offhand, but yeah, please leave it in the comments if you know specific parts that are used in there, so we can all like order them and get ourselves flagged. Awesome. You know, I just want to flash a LED, I want to blow up a cap, build a bloody plutonium bomb. Unbelievable. That's one of the questions you get asked actually sometimes when you're buying parts from the US. Will you use this to manufacture nuclear weapons? I'm thinking about ticking yes to see what happens. And of course I got his name wrong. He knew I would. He put it down here. It's Dufresne. I'm still probably getting it wrong. Anyway, it's silent S, not DeFresne. Sorry, Mike. Anyway, on to what I was looking forward to. Here we go. It's not the connected launch pad. It's what's inside. Be very, very careful. These things aren't cheap. Ta-da! I won't take them out of the packet, but they're Intel Xeon processors. Two of them. Beauty.
And here it is, the Intel Xeon E5-2630V2, 2.6 gig, made in Costa Rica. Fantastic. And Michael has been kind enough to send me two of these puppies, and they're actually quite expensive, even second hand. So the reason he sent these is because of my recent video and comments and things on my relatively slow video rendering machine. Like, I had an Intel i7 and it used to render very fast, twice real time, in fact, when I was doing 25 frames per second video. But now I'm shooting 50 or 60 frames per second video. It's now dropped down to about 1/4 real time, so a quarter real time. So it's like, I don't know, 6 or 8 times slower or something like that. So I'm going to need a new machine, and these two processors will be fantastic. I've got two identical ones, so the plan is to get a dual Xeon motherboard which supports these things. I think it's going to cost about $600 or something for the motherboard, but that is still quite cheap. This thing has a Passmark benchmark rating with the dual core of like 15,000, so that's like double my current Core i7 machine. And by the way, two of these things is not as fast as the absolute top of the line current latest i7, which is the 4000 series, something or other. Can't remember the number, but yeah, that is technically quicker because it's a faster processor. These are 6 cores each, so I have a total of 12 cores available. And so the new Intel Core processors are faster, but I would have to buy a new motherboard yet again. It is cheaper than a dual core motherboard, but the faster core processor is about $1,400. So this is a much cheaper solution, and I should at least double my rendering speed, possibly even more. So that's the plan. Thank you very much, Michael. I'm going to get a motherboard for this, and I'm going to build a dual core Xeon video rendering machine. So look out for a video of that once I get the motherboard and get it built. Thanks, Michael. This is awesome.
Next up, we have a FedEx box. This one comes from Alex Wong at Digilent Inc. We all know Digilent, the makers of the FPGA demo boards and everything else. Thank you very much, Alex. Ah, fail on the tear strip there. Ah, piss poor design. Anyway, we have a box inside the... hope it's not fragile. What do we have? Looks like we might have Digilent Beyond Theory. I do like their slogan. Let's have a look. What do we got? We have a t-shirt. What's on it? Oh, it's a Digilent, I don't know how to pronounce that, Zybo Zybo board. Thank you very much. And we got not one but two. That's the chip kit WF32 board. So there you go, terrific stuff. And yes, we do have another demo board. Obviously not going to do it in the mailbag because I can't do it in a couple of minutes. I got some cute little stickers. And this is the Basis 3. There you go, Basis 3 FPGA kit. What one does that have? It has the Artix 7, the new Artix series. Awesome, which has 33,000 logic cells, 5200 slices, 1.8 megabits of block RAM, internal clock speeds exceeding 450 meg. Jeez, when I was a boy. Serial flash, it's got UART, it's got 4 12-pin PMOD connectors. Oh, 12-bit VGA output as well. Fantastic. So you can hook it up to monitors. I've got tons of monitors here. Can hook them up and do really cool stuff because, as I've said before, a nice demo project for FPGAs is to drive directly a VGA output. And you can either do that with a DAC or whatever. You can even bodge it with some resistors if you want. So there you go. Hopefully they've got a demo. So I'll have to run that through its paces in another video. And the chipkit WF32, it's the PIC32 platform, but it's got built-in Wi-Fi. Sweet. I'll link both of these down below. There's got to be a separate video on each one of those. Thanks, Alex.
And here's the new Digilent Basis 3. You've seen the Basis 2 before, and there we go. That's the difference between the two. These ones used, the Basis 2 used the Spartan 3, the real old architecture Spartan 3. So they've upped that game. I think they might still sell the Basis 2. Anyway, this is the new Basis 3, and it's got the new Xilinx Arctic 7 FPGA. So very nice bit of kit, that one. And as I said, they've got a 12-bit VGA port now, as opposed to an 8-bit VGA port, which they had last time. They've got some little joysticky-like buttons. They've got four of these, the PMOD connectors, they call them. Presumably, they've got all the peripherals and stuff to plug into those if you want to do that. They've got a lot more switches than they did before. They've still got the 4-digit 7-segment display and USB in, and that should work a treat as an FPGA demo board. Oh, by the way, there's the bottom of it, and if you're wondering why they, like, there's a switching power supply around there, nice tight loop with its own ground plane around that. If you're wondering why they put that on the top and put, didn't put it on the top, and they put the bypass caps on the top instead, it's probably to do with room on this thing, because they've got to put, like, the Digilent logo and the Linear logo. They support this, probably provide parts at cost or something like that, and you know, you've got to leave room on the top for all this sort of labeling. So that's why they've chucked a lot of stuff on the bottom there. And I love, like, the bypass layout on here. I've had to do many of these. And you've got no choice, because you can't, here's the bottom of it, you can't necessarily whack them all on the bottom, because you're trying to fan out, sorry for my, excuse the crudity of my finger there, you're trying to fan out all of these traces. And you can whack them all on the bottom, of course, have them nicely tightly coupled, because the idea of bypass caps is to have them as physically close to the pin you're decoupling as possible. And large BGA parts like this one, they, you know, there's going to be a couple of rows of BGA pins out there. And if you've got, you know, your 8-layer board or something, okay, you can fan them all out and you can put all your bypass caps really close to the pins you mean to bypass on the bottom. But this is probably, this looks like maybe only a 4-layer board here. So, yeah, they've had to sort of compromise and put the caps out there. So it's all a trade-off with these FPGAs and bloody BGA packages. Grrr. Oh, look, it comes pre-programmed. Isn't that cute? So we've got all our individual LEDs there, and what if we do? Oh, yeah, look at that. There we go. And that will no doubt be a demo. I'll turn them all off, the center one. No doubt be a demo program you can start from, which is really handy. It probably displays something on the VGA output too. Might have to check that.
Whoa, psychedelic, man.
Unfortunately, though, this is more expensive than the Basis 2. This one is $150 US retail, or a much, much cheaper $79 academic price, if you can get that, if you're a student. And this Chipkit WF32 looks pretty jazzy. Look at that nice Wi-Fi module over there. Ah, beautiful. It's got the PIC32 processor, which is a very nice processor. No, it's not ARM. Microchip went with their own, with an alternative solution for their cores. But I still do, I like the PIC32 architecture. It's really quite nice. It's, you know, it's just good to have an alternative to ARM. Every man is dogs doing bloody arm. Anyway, there you go. If you're into your chip kits, this one with the Wi-Fi module. Woo. And of course, it's Arduino compatible. It's got the 80 megahertz MIPS PIC32 core, and it's a much more reasonable cost, $69. Not too bad at all, considering you get the Wi-Fi and the SD card built in. That's pretty jazzy.
Next up, brown paper bag time from persons unknown, but it comes from Melbourne. So hi to all my Melburnian viewers, let's take a look. For those who don't know, Melbourne is the second coolest city in Australia, apart from Sydney, of course. And let's have a squiz, huh? What do we got? Okay, let's go. Come on. Designed in Europe, made in Vietnam. It's a don't know what that is. Technicolor. Anyway, it's not that. It's got to be something else. Dave, a couple of items I found in the recent dumpster dive at work. A multi-trode indicator pump controller and a Powdu RGBS decoder. I'm sensing 2 2-minute teardowns.
Australian made, bloody ripper. 2-minute teardown, multi-trode, never heard of them. Some sort of pump, controller thingamabob. So there you go, multi-trode indicator pump controller. It's got a couple of tacked buttons on the front. Let's take a look at this puppy. That's a bit, look at that. I love the square routing on there. No, I don't. I'm being a bit cynical there. And, looks like we've got to undo that. Woo! And there we go. That's neat and tidy. It's about 98 vintage. This is the power supply. Little tiny heat sinks on these because, well, these are only powering like a 7.4 series Logic and processor, as we'll see on the other boards. And, yeah, we've got ourselves a nice little toroid there. We've got some... Looks like we've got some big mobs there by the looks of it. They're absolute monsters, but that's neat and tidy. They've done the square routing again. The electrons will just fly off the corners. Oh, goodness sake. And yeah, they've got that wire just earthed down in there. They've done that properly. That's all right. And then we've got our front panel. Oh, sorry, our rear panel here with all our connections and everything else. And just going to really old school pin header like that. A dip header. So yeah, we've got ourselves some inductors down in there and some relays, and looks like we've got more MOV protection across there as well. So that is all. It's conformally coded too. Check it out. There you go, 7.4 series Logic, and all pretty old school stuff. Look at this. We've got ourselves an 8031. Controller, with a real EEPROM and some real 6.264 SRAM there. So look at that, classic, and the routing, oh, beautiful. Really old school. I wonder, you know, like somebody's obviously not a PCB designer, not, you know, a real proper PCB designer. They're good enough to get the job done. The layout's quite nice and everything else, as in like the component parts placement is quite nice, but yeah, they've just really done it old school square routing. Yeah, they just come from a different era, perhaps. Anyway, looks like we have some a bunch of inductors down here go into this pin header on the side, which goes to the rear connector. So there you go, a couple of trimmers and Bob's your uncle, whole bunch of miscellaneous, and got some optocouplers over there, but nothing much doing. And yeah, these pin headers, as I said, dip headers, really old school stuff. Oh, gotta be careful when taking these out. You can often slip like that and you pierce your thumb with one of those, and yeah, it's worse than standing on a Lego brick, let me tell you. You'll be screaming from here to Timbuktu. And old school dip tantalums. Ah, geez, nobody uses dip tantalums anymore. They were horrible bastards, they were. And we've got an inline brand 2093 Powdu RGBS decoder. And there we go. That's neat and tidy. They've got a right angle IEC mains connector down there. It's fused PCB mount transformer. They've strapped it down lovely with cable ties. And it dates from about 91. There we go, 1991 or so. That's interesting. At first, that looked like a big ass mains filter cap, but of course it's, you know, it's not in the right location for that surrounding all of this sort of stuff. But it's got DL2 down there. It's a delay line. It must be. DL must stand for delay line. And we've got a Philips TDA3566A. I'll link in the data sheet for that puppy. And we've got ourselves a genuine bodge board using a 4098 4000 series Logic. Oh, it's a bit of a shame that they've bodged that in there, but there you go. And on the back, we've got ourselves the power composite input to the RGB out with the sink. Oh, someone's had a little mouse has had a nibble at that. And we've got ourselves another flying bodge down there. Look at that. Completely hacked. It's a shame because that's a otherwise a nice, neat product. I don't mind that at all. And then they went and ruined it with some bodges. Ah, well. Thank you very much, John. Interesting 2-minute teardown.
And by the way, there are a few here that have had like 3 or 4 sucks of the salve. So I'm not going to open those today. They go to the end of the pile. I'm looking at you, R. Spitzenfield and Smart Boards. I think they've been on like 3 or 4 times. So, yeah, you go to the bottom of the pile. Thanks for playing. Jake Myers from Rochester in MN. What's MN? Minnesota or something? I don't know. Sorry. I don't know all my US states. I've probably got that right before, but anyway, I'm having a mental breakdown at the moment, as you do. So thank you very much, Jake. Ooh. There is a note, but I have no idea. That's got to be a car module. That's something out of a car, surely. Hi, Dave. My name is Jake Myers. I'm an electronics engineer with a second bachelor's degree in physics. Oh, from Minnesota. There you go. Where average is about -5 to -15 right now. This was back in, I think he sent it in November. Oops. Sorry, Jake. And Jake looks like he buys and fixes up and tweaks and hacks old cars, Subarus in particular. So, yes, this is an ECU from a Subaru, the one with the automatic transmission. Apparently, the ECU's different. Apparently, there is a hacking community for these things. They like to tweak and mod them and stuff like that. So, there you go. No, I don't think I've torn down an ECU before. I've torn down an airbag controller, I think it was, but not an ECU. And that is a view from Jake's backyard. I have no idea what that white stuff is. Weird bloody Americans? I don't know.
And a quick 2-minute teardown of Jake's ECU from an automatic Subaru. Got ourselves some NEC SIP parts down in there. It's like, if these are in a car, I would not trust a SIP package like that due to vibration. I know there's a lot of pins and it's really hard to bend those, but geez, I don't know. And then we've got ourselves looking like a ceramic hybrid over here. And just from a vibration design point of view, I probably would have got shot down at a design review meeting for even considering. And here we go. We've got ourselves a TO220 plastic case transistor, by the looks of it, NEC transistor there, just flapping in the breeze. So, and we've got another SIP package there, or is it staggered? Yeah, it's a SIP package over to the side for some heat sinking there. So, and this is the ECU. No idea what that processor is. WA, blah, blah, blah. I don't know. Maybe Jake can help us out there. It's a weird looking one. Anyway, he says they are hackable, so presumably people have done the firmware and things like that. We've got ourselves, looks like a big ass Motorola. I see Motorola Dio down in there. And not much else, just a bunch of miscellaneous stuff. But yeah, I'm not sure what that hybrid's doing over there. Anyway, interesting. It's got a couple of raised, it's got a raised part on that side down in there. And then they've just molded that, of course. But yeah, I'm a bit surprised. Not conformally coded at all, as opposed to the previous board we saw. So, yeah, huge, big, custom right-angle connector down in here. Geez, I don't know how much that would have cost them to custom make that. But hey, this is the automotive industry. They're making, you know, hundreds of thousands of these things. Probably common across, you know, a whole series of cars and things like that. So, anyway, that is a neat layout, apart from the vibrational issues. I'm sure it's fine. It's probably proven to be fine, of course, but they would have done their homework on it. And Jake says that they are very well proven and robust. Like, in, he says they can survive 20, 30 years in the Minnesota weather, which is, and the corrosion, the salty roads, -90°C temperature swings throughout the year. 90°C swing? Wow. Okay, and there you go. Yeah, like, I'm surprised that it's not conformally coded was my first thing. And they've got a couple of electrolytics over here. Can't see the brand of those. Might just snap them off. And there we go. No surprises. The big M there, the Golden Arches, that's Panasonic, actually. It's Matsushita, who are now owned by Panasonic. And no, they are not shit caps, even though they come from Matsushita. And all three are the same brand, Matsushita, 105 degree C rated. So yeah, they've done their homework on that. Well qualified as well. I mean, you know, a big part of these is the actual design qualification testing. So I'm sure they went through all the vibration stuff, all the thermal chamber cycling, and all, you know, all the endurance testing and stuff like that. And turns out very well proven, apparently.
Next up, from a country we don't get one from very often, Sri Lanka. This is from Dushka, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, from Nujigoda. I'm sure that's right. Sounds Aboriginal, Nujigoda. Anyway, thank you very much. Let's have a look. Look at those stamps. Ooh, nice. No, I didn't want to cut through. No, this is not looking... There we go, that's better. All right, what have I got? Oh, what's this? It's not electronic. Let's read the note first. Hi Dave, from the day I can remember, I love taking things apart and seeing how they work. I started watching your videos while doing O-Level. I assume that's some sort of course over there. Engineering course. Your videos and amp hour has inspired me, given lots of knowledge and experience, included a wall hanger. Sorry, couldn't send the wall hanging frame. It's too long. Anyway, it's a batik painting of our country's traditional Isala Pereira in Kandy with a K. Also included a postcard of it. Thank you very much, Dunushka. From the small island, from small island in the Indian Ocean. Fantastic. Oh, wow. It's lucky I've got the wide angle lens. Cool. Hey, check it out. Have I got that up the right way? Yes, I have. Is it backwards? Yeah, look at that. Awesome. Thanks. That's terrific. The wife will like that. I wish I was there. Look at that. Fantastic. And Sri Lanka, they don't play a bad game of cricket either. Beauty. Looks like the Australian Customs weren't happy with this one. Probably because they put Austria on it. Anyway, I don't know who this one is from. Open for inspection. Jeez. Usually they don't give a toss. They just let it through. Ah, yeah, no worries. She'll be right. No, Australian Customs are actually extremely strict. If you try and come into Australia with, like, a packet of nuts, oh, man, they'll go nuts, let me tell you. So I don't know who this is from. Let's have a squiz. Yeah, one of the strictest customs in the world. I think only surpassed by New Zealand, perhaps, because, you know, they try and keep their country pristine, as you'd expect. Oh, wow, look at this. Casio FX790P personal computer. Oh, wow, awesome. This was sold... Does it work? There's no battery in there. This was actually... I lusted after one of these. These were rebadged, as a lot of Casio stuff was, rebadged by Tandy, i.e. Radio Shack, who have now practically gone bust. And yeah, I'm not sure. I think it was like the PC, was this like the PC-8 or something like that? Anyway, separate scientific calculator keypad, which was fantastic. So that is an interesting little puppy. Probably deserves something better than a 2-minute teardown. Made in Japan, of course. And we have a board. And Stefan's done this board. He wants me to take a quick look at it. It's very simple. It's a synchronous rectifier, basically an electronic rectifier, instead of using like a replacement for a bridge rectifier, instead of using lossy diodes as you're used to in your traditional bridge arrangement. You can actually use a smart controller with some MOSFETs like this, i.e. That's a reason you have four of them, because it works exactly how a bridge rectifier works, except it, of course, the low on resistance of the MOSFETs eliminates the loss, and of course the 0.6 volts drop per diode at least. You know, it can be like a volt at the higher currents for the diode bridges, and if you've got two of them, well, you're pissing away 2 volts there. Very lossy, your regular diode bridges, so these are vastly more efficient for your regular linear power supplies and things like that. But if even though you've got linear supplies, you want to make them more efficient still. So you use these MOSFET-based synchronous rectifiers.
And the LT4220, which I'll link in down below, can handle up to 72 volts peak and 60 hertz or 600 hertz if you go up to the LT4320. And of course, you need the big filter cap on the output as well. And ta-da, there's his little board. And this is Stefan's first board, so I'll be gentle. Dip, of course, through hole. We've got nice, big, square, large diameter pads, huge solder space around those, fantastic stuff. And there's our smallish output filter cap here. And he's got massive traces going along here. Quite a few vias there for the stitch in, but you don't obviously need that when you've got the massive thing in there, but it's a nice touch. Anyway, he's got that going around there, a nice solid trace into the input pin of the MOSFET, and then coming out like that. See, I would have flipped that around. Well, it depends whether or not you're mounting these on heat sinks. If you're mounting them on heat sinks, then of course you want them in the both, you want the tabs both like this and this. So you want them in the same direction. But if you're not mounting them on heat sinks, you would have flipped that around, rotated around so that this, so it just didn't have to travel all the way around like that. And then under like that, I would have flipped that one over and then, this could have gone directly to that pin, and then this would have been the same, but this path around here would have been a lot shorter. But anyway, he's got nice big, like 100 thou traces going into those pads. No problems whatsoever. So that's really quite nice. I like that. And you have got that bypass cap there, nice and close to the pin, two output pins here. Effectively, this cap is in parallel with this one, but of course, it would have been a mistake to whack it over here because, well, that's not the purpose of it. The purpose is to have that smaller value, that one mic, just near to the output pins there. And you can see that tray, so it picks it off. That V is going down to the output here, so that's just fine and dandy. But it's right bang close to the pins exactly where it should be. So that's really quite neat. So, you know, it's hard to fault that at all. A bit of wasted space, of course, in the middle if you were going for a compact layout. I know you've got, you know, this big trace going over here. It doesn't have to be that big. The board could have been made slightly smaller depends on how you're going to mount the heat sinks on those FETs, whether or not you actually have to. I don't know the losses offhand in this thing, but yeah, that's not too shabby at all. I like that. And of course, you have to use a reasonable capacity soldering iron over here to solder in the huge wires down to here, because these big pads will suck away some of the heat. But that's what you'd typically do on this board. You wouldn't be too concerned about that. You'd be looking just to get the maximum amount of current path possible on this thing. And that's exactly what he's done. So that's quite neat. I don't know what the maximum current is on this. I haven't looked it up, but and he didn't specify. But anyway, that's not a bad job at all, Stefan, who wants me to call him Steve. Call you Bruce. G'day, Bruce. I have to link in the Bruce's sketch down below for those who don't get it. Next up, one from Hong Kong. Don't get many from Hong Kong, so hi to all my... It's not Hong Kongian viewers. I'm sure all my viewers from Hong Kong, please give me the correct pronunciation for that. This one's from Meet Edison. So let's meet Edison, shall we? This could be fun. We have a box. No note. Edison, it's a robot. Let's have a look. Okay, I think Sagan might like this. Oh, Daddy might like it too. Oh, isn't that jazzy? There we go. It's the Edison robot. Turn my face tracking off, sorry, on my camera. There we go. Look at that puppy. Nice little orange, and it's one of these, is it a line following robot? Because I think I see, like, because it's only the two wheels plus the thing. So it's obviously designed to go on the front surface like that. I've got the rubber boots for the wheels. It looks like there's a little, maybe an Atmel processor in there or something. But yeah, let's check it out. And let's meet Edison. This is the Edison robot, and this was a Kickstarter campaign, educational robot. They raised 120 grand or so from their, or 112 or something from their 20 grand target. So fantastic, congratulations, and they've obviously delivered. And if you're wondering why it looks weird with all these bumps, is because yes, it is Lego compatible. Fantastic, and it is designed for education for kids to learn robotics, and it is very simple. We've just got a differential drive here. Looks like we've got some control buttons on the top. We'll power it up in a minute, but anyway, it uses a Edware icon-based graphical user interface programming system, and it uses the headphone jack on your computer. If we get in here, here's the little custom works on four AAAs by the looks of it. I'll power it up in a second. And it uses the headphone jack on the computer to send and receive data. So you whack that in, and that obviously goes somewhere on a data port. Yeah, there it is, down there. There we go. There's our little data port, and it can send and receive data via your sound card. So that's pretty jazzy. And we've got an LED on the bottom there that allows it to scoot around on that with its differential drive. It's an obstacle avoidance system. It's got two IR LEDs. It's got a red LED and a photo transistor on it. So it can actually read barcodes and things like that. There's their little symbol. And yeah, that is really neat product. I don't mind that at all. Let's fire it up. Oh, $59, by the way. Okay, let's give it a bell. I'm just pushing buttons random, monkey style. hoping Shakespeare will come out the other end, but go. Go, you little beauty. You can do it. You can do it. Do something. Woo! Woo! There it goes. There it goes. It's supposed to like have an obstacle avoidance system, but it looks like it's just going around in circles at the moment. Yeah, I think I should just read the manual. Actually, this is looking really quite jazzy. All this software is open source, and there's a whole bunch of stuff. This is printed out from the manual, which I didn't get. And this is the learn button here, the circle. So it drives over this barcode, and we can, in this case, we'll put it into the clap control driving, because it's got a microphone in there, it can detect claps. So it's going to drive over that. I haven't tried it yet, but hopefully it will. And then it'll program it, one of its pre-programmed things, like it's got line following and all sorts of things. One of them's a clap-based mode. So let's try it. And that's start and stop the currently programmed program. Or you can program it with your own custom stuff. So let's go, press that. And it's supposed to drive. Supposed to drive. Press the record round button 3 times. There we go. Ha! Didn't read the instructions, did I? There we go. So it's now in clap mode. So if I press go, should just sit there. And if I go, yeah, there we go. And it's supposed to go forward, I think. Whoa, yeah, there we go. Neat. I think it's responding to my voice. No, it's just going to turn around. Anyway, it's very cool. And you can do line following programs and or learn, as I said, icon-based programming language and stuff like that. So that is really neat. Check it out for $60, and you get like educational packs with like, you know, 30 in a pack for like a whole class. And that's really quite nicely engineered. They've done a really good job like that, and clearly they've delivered on their Kickstarter. I assume they've delivered. Oh, and I've got one of the first run, I guess. I don't know the date of it. They could have been shipping them for ages, but check it out. That is a nice little robot. I think Sagan's going to have a lot of fun with that, let alone Daddy. There you go. There's something you don't see that often these days. Freescale processor. I mean, you know, they're like number one or number two in the world manufacturer, but they're mostly used in industrial applications. I would have, you know, expected an Atmel or a PIC in here. Anyway, we've got ourselves a discrete transistor H-bridge driver there. You can tell it's a H-bridge because it's got 4 transistors there, and not much else. I won't take it apart further, but that's there we go. There's our buttons under there. There's our surface mount buzzer. And that's a pretty jazzy design. I really like that. It's quite neat. But of course, all the magic, of course, goes into the software and everything else. And I like the fact that it's Lego compatible. I wonder if they've officially used the Lego name or how that actually works, whether or not, obviously, I don't think they use their logo, I'm not sure, but yeah, I wonder if you have to pay for that or how anal they are about that. Maybe you can just say, oh, it's Lego compatible, and if you don't use their logo, then yeah, you're probably fine, but that is jazzy. Thanks, guys. That's awesome work. Absolutely awesome. And check out the attention to detail here. They've got this little rubber mat which like sits up in the slot in there and surrounds that lead there. Obviously they had to keep out extraneous light and only get it from where they wanted it, and that is that's quite jazzy. They got a lot of effort there. Well done. So if you're interested in this little puppy, check it out, link down below. And that's it for mailbag Tuesday. I'm shooting this on, oops. Better go edit it now. Catch you next time.